Hey there, my name is AJ Pickett, and this is the Mighty Gluestick, and it's time to talk about red dragons. Well, mostly red dragons. I'll also like to address a few other general draconic topics that crop up time and time again in this video, so bear with me. I'll try to keep it entertaining. Red dragons are the archetype of dragons in general and are absolutely the icons of Dungeons & Dragons. They are universally recognized and have been with us in story and symbology for a very long time. We know them today as the scarlet, scaled, horn-crested, big, violent, and very touchy, flame-breathing, chromatic villains. But in the early days of the game lore, the dragons were not as fixed in their design as they are now. I'd say that the illustration of the red dragon from 2nd edition Advanced Dungeons & Dragons was the emergence of the modern appearance of red dragons. Actually, if you check out this illustration of Tiamat, goddess of evil dragons, from the 1st edition Monster Manual, you can see that the distinctive designs of each chromatic head were missing, even though the idea that each colour of her heads would have a different style was already there. The style of the red dragon is based on flames, of course, with spikes, splays, and fluted membranes that emulate the flickering flames and smouldering embers. They are creatures of elemental power and also beings of magic, quite different from anything else. Every part of a red dragon has some aspect of magical and elemental power infused into it. Their biological makeup is alien, it doesn't conform to the usual rules of living things. They're more like a fusion between very different life forms, much like the Genasi or genies fuse elemental power with a mortal soul. Dragon souls are elemental power. Many dragons diffuse their power into the world when they die, and technically speaking, they don't have a soul in the same sense that other mortal creatures do. They don't travel to the outer planes as petitioner souls. They don't have the same attitude towards those outer planes either. To them, they're just other dimensions for them to dwell in. They are not immortal beings. They don't have the same soul potential. There is no afterlife for them beyond the astral plane, so to speak. For them, the primaterial plane and the elemental planes are much more important and real. However, when it comes to mortal incarnate beings of monstrous power, not much outclasses a dragon. In fact, it is within the power of dragons to actually destroy the abyss and restore the multiverse to what it once was. But more on that in another video. Now, I took the opportunity to ask the YouTube community what they wanted to know about red dragons, and you certainly gave me a lot to research, covering a huge range of lore and all the different settings and editions. So I'll do my best to compare red dragons across the world settings, some of them, including Dragonlance, Greyhawk, Spelljammer and Pathfinder, Council of Worms, Mystara and so on, all took inspiration. We will take a look at their diet. We'll take a look at kobolds, spellcasting, population density, the relationship between the Githyanki, and even the subject of good aligned red dragons. So grab yourself a hot beverage and a snack. We're about to get very deeply nerdy. The 2nd edition Monstrous Manual for Advanced Dungeons & Dragons describes red dragons as the most covetous and greedy of all the dragons, forever seeking to increase their treasure hoards. They're obsessed with their wealth and memorize every inventory accurate to the last copper. They are exceptionally vain and self-confident, considering themselves superior not only to other dragons, but all other life in general. Despite the vast majority of them being quite evil, they're not universally evil as a breed. It's a rare thing to encounter a good red dragon, and also, as with any intelligent living creature, their alignment may change many times over the course of their very long lives. Yes, alignments in monsters can change, just as player character alignments can. Why not? Is it possible, though, for some player characters to actually cause this change of heart in a dragon? Maybe. After all, to deny the joys of a campaign where their objective is to redeem rather than murder all the evil beings in the world, perhaps even reform devils and demons, I would never say that the rules should forbid it, simply because they don't. If you want to address the theme of nature versus nurture in your games and have the player characters attempt to curb the red dragon's behaviour, I see nothing wrong with that at all. In fact, I have some good suggestions for you. Let's say the player characters get their hands on a red dragon egg and hatch it, then decide they're going to raise that hatchling to be good. And the first obstacle is that the dragon hatchling is born able to speak, read, and understand sorcery, and a lot of the instincts that are present in humanoid infants is just completely absent in the red dragon. They're not completely dependent on humans for longer than a few days. They have a powerful instinct to hunt and kill prey, and they are just naturally extremely territorial. And they are the ultimate hoarders from the moment they are biting anyone who tries to steal the broken remains of their egg. The characters will quickly come to realize, hopefully, that greed and praise are the keys to controlling the hatchling's behavior, and that scolding, lecturing, or talking to them like they're an infant is a really bad idea. Raising a red dragon just like you would raise a humanoid child, with the hope that they will turn out thinking and acting like a good-natured humanoid, is just stupid. Red dragons are apex predators, isolationists, and do not respond to any instinct to be an accepted part of the group. They will always, always see themselves as the leaders of a group and the owners of everything the group has. They'll see those who praise them as their minions, not their parents. Let me give you an example of how fundamentally different a dragon infant is from a humanoid child. If the humanoid child catches the neighbor's pet and kills it slowly like a cat with a mouse, they would be a real cause for concern. One might chastise that child, beat them and take away things to punish them, make them apologize to the neighbor and so on. If you chastise the hatchling, it's going to ignore your idiot babble. If you beat it, it's going to fight back. And if you manage to thrash them soundly, the hatchling is going to see you as a rival and possibly a potential mate, which would be disastrous. Taking away their stuff, not going to happen. Apologize to the neighbor, also not going to happen. The dragon hatchling will probably just demand that they get more pets and steal their silverware while they're at it. Yes, you can slowly but surely curb these antisocial and predatory behaviors over time with a hell of a lot of patience and determination, but chances are it's just going to result in a red dragon that tends not to immolate humanoids like they were vermin, playthings, and salty little flame-grilled snacks. Working within the limitations of the dragon's own instincts and desires is the key. The only other option is using magic and mind control to forcibly alter the behavior, which is actually quite unethical, even to a creature which is otherwise going to be evil itself. So it's a catch-22. There's always the possibility that the dragon gods, or just sheer fluke, random chance, may result in an uncharacteristically good-natured red dragon. But keep in mind that for the rest of its life, it will have to accept the fact that it is an outcast among its own kind, who will most likely one day end up murdering it as a traitor to Tiamat and being a revolting weakling. The good red dragon is anything but a weakling, of course, but that's just the prejudice its own evil kin will direct at it. Speaking of hatchlings and mating, let's talk about that. Once every century or so, a female red dragon will feel the urge to reproduce, and she simply announces the fact that she is going to mate with a male who just automatically accepts. There's no courtship, really. There is a good reason for this. The females select the mate based on his formidable reputation in combat, as well as the size of his hoard of treasure. Being nice or pretty or his feelings in the matter have got nothing to do with it. If he refuses, the female will either select what is most likely his worst enemy or be so insulted that she'll try to murder him. For the males, being selected as a mate by a female is critical to their social status and their ego. And with red dragons, oh, you better believe everything is about their ego. While the hoard of treasure serves other purposes, red dragons tend to believe it not only assures them a good chance at fathering offspring, but also pleases Tiamat and the other draconic gods. Females collect vast treasure hoards as well, of course. It's a sign of status amongst all red dragons, regardless of gender. Their coupling is violent and dangerous as an activity. The dragons will meet at a certain spot, roar challenges at each other, fight, set forests on fire, cause a volcanic eruption, or some such, and in the midst of all the fury and chaos, they will mate. If you're witness to the actual deed, it's pretty quick, and the male departs immediately after the fact because the female got what she wanted from him and is now back to being just another hated rival. If you have some fanciful notions of a loving relationship between red dragons developing, well, it's not impossible, but keep in mind there's no such thing as physical intimacy between red dragons. If they make physical contact outside of an actual mating, it will result in violence 100% of the time. Look at it this way. The male dragon, proudly displaying its missing eye and ear, will brag that any lesser male would never survive a fight with its mate, and all the other dragons are unworthy and its mate chose it wisely. They're not humanoids. They don't think like humanoids, and if anything, they also find humanoid mating habits to be ridiculous and disgusting. Also, no sane red dragon would ever, ever mate while polymorphed into any other form. Does it seem like I'm heading off a lot of half dragon and crossbreed dragon questions before they get asked in the comment section? Okay, so let's talk about half dragons of the red dragon variety for a moment. Half red dragons are not the result of red dragons mating with humanoids. It would be instantly fatal to any humanoid, and the actual reproductive organs are totally different between a humanoid and a dragon anyway. Half red dragons are the result of magical essence of the dragon being infused into the mortal and resulting in a pregnancy. It doesn't have to be a male dragon doing this to a female humanoid. A male dragon can do this to a male human who transfers this essence, resulting in a half dragon pregnancy. The mother is protected from the gestation because the baby forms in a leathery sac inside the womb, which is born not long after. The mother typically protects the egg sac fiercely, keeping it as hot as possible, including resting it in a bed of burning coals, and the half-dragon stays in that sac-like egg for some time before hatching. At birth, it's quite tiny, but grows very rapidly, depending on how much food and elemental energy it can consume. Half-red dragons become independent as soon as they can hunt small game, and they don't have an instinct to remain with the mother. Just get the idea of red dragons in love out of your head. The only thing a red dragon loves is itself. True red dragons produce half-dragons for lots of different reasons, but they most certainly don't do it out of love, desire, affection, or attraction for humanoids. Also, they really don't have any desire to mate with any other breed of dragon because none of the others are as perfect as their own kind. Dragon crossbreeds between different types of dragons are rare anyway, as the elemental and magical power of the dragons doesn't tend to mix easily, and particularly with the chromatic dragons, a crossbreed can be quite random. It may have traits that are nothing like either of its parent breeds. Female red dragons will guard their eggs as they incubate in some hot environment over the next 270 days. Sometimes a subservient female red dragon, or an older female who can't have hatchlings of her own anymore, will also guard the clutch of eggs. Normally there will be four eggs in the clutch, and when they do finally hatch, there will be a supernatural surge of elemental energy in the region, causing a heat wave, a forest fire, volcanic event, or even a shower of meteors. The hatchlings will stay with the mother until they are no more than young adults, but at some point the mother will revert back to her usual draconic instincts and start to see the offspring as nothing more than potential rivals and threats, causing her to get more and more aggressive towards them until one day she drives them off and lets them know that if they encroach on their territory again, she'll kill them. There's quite a lot of interest in the subject of red dragons and the Githyanki, so let's talk about that for a few minutes. Red dragons have a special relationship with the astral raiders known as the Githyanki. The story goes that during the war against the Mind Flayers, Vlakif the First, Gith's advisor, made a suggestion to her to seek out allies from different planes to aid in their war of liberation across the multiverse. She specifically advised her to talk with Tiamat, the queen of evil dragons, and so Gith ventured into the Nine Hells to form an allegiance, but she never came back. Her soul is still around, a treasure that resurfaces in the lore now and then. Instead, Ephemelon, the red dragon envoy, relayed the news that Tiamat had agreed and let her red dragons become servants to the Githyanki's cause against the Mind Flayers, while keeping Gith hostage in the Nine Hells. In addition, Vlakith was to take Gith's place as ruler until her return. Ooh, fun fact time, hold on to your socks. It has now been established in the lore that the Githyanki and Gith Sarai were originally humans, captured by the Mind Flayers, and that the Mind Flayers not only mutated and conditioned them into the form they now have, as egg-laying, leathery, yellow-skinned, black-eyed, and clawed fingers and toes, but they also killed their god. This answers a very long-running question and mystery as to what happened to the humans' original creator god. Take it or leave it, but it's now supported by the lore, and I think it's a delicious fuel for countless campaigns to try and travel to the dead god that floats at Faragos, exuding magical power into that place, somehow reviving that god, and well, who knows what would happen? Anyway, under the agreement between Gith and Tiamat, a small number of red dragons serve as an aid to the Githyanki knights and warriors without interfering in politics nor offering any sort of advice. But the Githyanki and dragons are prohibited from using their abilities against each other. These dragons start serving the Githyanki masters at a young age. When they reach adulthood, they are replaced by younger dragons. In return, they take their accumulated loot from raids. This tradition is now a part of what you would call the Draconic Society of the Red Dragons. It makes a lot of sense for young red dragons to do this because it serves as a form of service to Tiamat, and it gets some combat experience with the protection of Githyanki knights and raiding vessels. They go on a fun tour of the Primaterial Plane and many other outer planes, and they grow to adult size away from the danger of older reds taking them out. When they do return to their chosen world, they have a decent hoard of treasure, and their tour of duty is seen as an admirable and intimidating achievement that makes them far more attractive to other red dragons, giving them a better chance of attracting the attention of a female. Or in the case of the females, they have been free of the backstabbing and drama and can simply return, pick a mate, and then go on with their lives. I would hazard a guess to say that female red dragons have a higher chance of staying in service to the Githyanki for longer, but keep in mind that red dragons are not serving the Githyanki, they are serving Tiamat. They won't attack the Githyanki as long as they are treated with the utmost respect. The tactics used by the Githyanki raiders are quite effective, and the dragons not only serve as mobile ship destroyers, but they also cling to the hull of a Githyanki vessel and protect it from what might otherwise be a blind, undefended spot. Closing into grappling range with a Githyanki ship is next to impossible with a red dragon blasting fire at anything that gets too close. Some red dragons have become native to the astral plane thanks to the ancient relationship, and they only travel outside the astral plane to let time pass for them normally and increase their size, age, and power. Red dragons who are reaching the very end of their long, long lifespans may travel to the astral plane. Case in point is on the famous dragon I was asked to talk about, the dragon Ashardalon. Ashardalon is famous for going to extraordinary lengths to extend his own lifespan, to the point that after he received a mortal wound one time, he found a Baelor demon and bound it to himself. Still visible is a huge patch of leather demon skin on his chest, sort of binding the demon's heart with his own. This was not actually sufficient to keep him alive, so he broke into the astral domain called the Bastion of Unborn Souls, a very, very taboo thing to do that got him into lots of trouble with gods and primordial powers who were quite angry with him. In there, he is free of the passage of ordinary time because he's still on the astral plane and absorbs vital energy unique to that place, which is where all the new souls come from. Now, that raises some other questions, such as what does a being eat while in the astral plane? Or do they have even a need to eat on the astral plane? Or is that not how the timelessness works? Well, I can answer questions about dragon cuisine at least. We can ponder the astral plane some other time. Dragons follow many of the same rules for nutrition that regular massive flying creatures do. We can base these figures on the extrapolation of monitor lizards and Komodo dragons, and you can thank the mainstream attention of Game of Thrones for this research. Now, carnivores tend to eat less often than herbivores thanks to the nutritional availability of what they eat, and some reptiles have been known to go surprisingly, shockingly long times without eating anything. Days, weeks, months, that kind of thing. Depending on how fast their metabolism is, it might go an entire season without eating, many, many months, and then their metabolism speeds up again and they eat again. Red dragons are typical of their species in that they will have periods of heavy activity and lots of eating, followed by an extraordinary long time of sleeping in their lair. Years, decades, even a century for really ancient dragons of enormous size. Now, dragons are not reptiles. They are a different order of life that shares a lot of the morphological traits just because of how they live and what they eat. But dragons are also infused with elemental power, and that provides a huge amount of their metabolic energy, to the point that dragons in very elementally active areas or with access to elemental power don't need to eat organic matter at all. They just do it for pleasure. The older the dragon gets, the less it tends to need to eat other creatures and the more infused with elemental power they become. The elemental power also helps with the dragon's energy efficiency in flight, which compensates for the lack of wingspan in relation to body mass for the really big dragons. But if you go too far down the pseudo-scientific rabbit hole, well, it's sufficient to say that dragons are very magical and weird creatures. This raises the age-old question, if they are kind of part elemental, can you eat a red dragon? Well, actually, yes, you can, and there's lore for this as well, thanks to the Draconomicon Chromatic Dragons published in November 2008, which says that the flesh of a red dragon tasted extremely spicy. To be properly prepared, it has to be exposed to open air for at least 2 days and aged for some time. Anyone who ate red dragon meat that was not treated in this manner was susceptible to horrible cramps and extreme pain. Nutritionally, it's very dense, on a par with yak meat, but with almost zero fat, like kangaroo meat. Also, I hope you like it very rare, because obviously, red dragon meat is not going to react much to heat. I suggest a good marinade, or dry it to make some dragon jerky. The next question in regard to red dragons is also about dragons. In general, what is the population density of dragons in the fantasy worlds? Well, it varies from world to world, considerably. Toril is an old world that has long been a location of interest for planes travellers and spelljammers. It has a very rich and diverse biosphere that supports an enormous amount of wildlife and has a wide array of different climates and terrain types. On the continent of Faerun, many mountain ranges stretch across the landscape for thousands of miles, so there's no great shortage of suitable lair sites for mountain-loving red dragons. They most often run into competition from their own kind, but also tend to live uncomfortably close to copper dragons, and the reds have quite a dislike of gold dragons, resenting their respect and power much more than they would ever willingly admit. you would expect there to be many more who are less famous or just too young to have made much of a name for themselves for this reason. Also, the nature of dragons to sleep for long periods of time means that it's very difficult to give an accurate estimate. Red dragons are very territorial, however, they are known to come together to combine their formidable power in displays of terrible dominance. These are the so-called dragon flights. Aside from those amazing gatherings, red dragons may develop traits that allow them to live around others of their kind in a clan. This is much more common with groups of younger male dragons, particularly those who are returning to the world after a few centuries of service in the Gathyanki Foreign Legion, but you can find clans of mixed gender or, as I mentioned, a fertile female with an infertile companion who will assist in raising some new hatchlings. Personally, I think it's conservative to say that there could be as many as one young adult red dragon per 400 miles of mountainous terrain. For the ancient raids, it could be as many as one per 1,000 miles or so. I could certainly be wrong. The different breeds of the dragons are also in fierce rivalry with each other, so that further limits the possible density of a complete population of red dragons. Perhaps there could be many more if there were only red dragons in the world, but as we know, there are way more breeds all competing for the same resources except for their favorite terrain types. Red dragons thrive on this intense and deadly rivalry, though. They relish a fight with other dragons. They are large, powerful brawlers. Not that great at flying close quarters, so they'll rip into the wings of any enemy dragon and take their fight to the ground if they have to. Otherwise, from a high perch within their hill or mountain country, they will haughtily survey their territory, which they consider to be everything they can see from their position. They prefer to lair in large caves that extend deep into the earth, but will gravitate towards geothermally active zones as well, such as volcanic event sites. Red dragons will also tend to sense geothermal events before they happen. This has led to some mistaken legends about fights between rival ancient red dragons setting off volcanoes. Fact is, they sensed the impending eruption and were fighting over the right to claim the new prime real estate. Fighting a red dragon on its own turf often includes all the natural dangers of the mountains and very rough terrain that is quite unsuitable for horses. The lair of a red dragon is a challenge for survival in and of itself, but more on fighting red dragons later in this video. Talking of lairs, one has to mention kobolds. One thing I often include in my campaign is the mass movement of tribes of kobolds who are relocating from an old lair site to a new one, carrying a lot of the dragon's treasure with them. Kobolds who serve red dragons tend to be swalbolds. They are larger, more aggressive, and don't tend to tolerate the lesser kinds of kobolds. Thanks to ready access to a lot of heat, they tend to master blacksmithing and equip themselves with well-made armor and weapons. Dragons also use magic items, wear armor, and carry additional weapons, though usually these are made to be extensions and enhancement of their own existing claws, fangs, and such. Oh, that's a good time to mention Thembichild, the red dragon located in the deep dwarf city of Grackelstug in the northern underdark of Faerun. He's what you call a wormsmith, a captive red dragon kept to make use of its magical flames to smelt metal, work it, and temper it into the finest metal blades. Thembichild has known for years that his keepers have been concealing things from him, such as their plan to execute him when he gets too powerful and dangerous for them to control. His keepers, known as the Monastic Order of the Keepers of Flame, keep a stash of red dragon eggs and manipulate the extremely vain and egotistical red dragon in their charge using mind-controlling psionics, but also catering to the dragon's every whim. Which I guess, since the Deep Dwarves consider dragonfire so valuable as to go to such extraordinary and dangerous lengths to get it on demand, we should talk about the red dragon's flame breath. The fundamentum is an organ unique to dragons. Once thought to be the source of a dragon's breath weapon, the fundamentum is an enormous blood vessel, like an extremely large complex artery. The fundamentum channels the energy-rich blood from the heart directly into the upper stomach of a dragon's gizzard. The gizzard of a dragon contains two hollows, a smaller upper stomach and the gizzard chamber proper. The elemental energy transferred from the heart through the fundamentum, sort of squeezed out, remains in the upper stomach until needed. This energy either aids in digestion, in which case it flows into the gizzard whenever food arrives from the esophagus, or it comprises the dragon's breath weapon. In truth, the breath weapon is a misnomer, since the fire, poison, acid, or other substance discharges not from the lungs, but from the upper stomach. The stream of energy is more accurately vomited than exhaled. Traces of this energy might leak from a dragon's upper stomach into the esophagus, mouth, and nostrils, from which they emerge like puffs of smoke or wisps of poison. another reason people believe the breath weapon is part of the respiratory system. This leaking energy also causes damage dealt by most dragon bites. After food reaches the gizzard, the hard plates inside the organ, similar in composition to the horns and teeth, grind it up, and the upper stomach bathes the swallowed food and energy from its pool. This is why dragons can literally digest elemental energy. They can soak it across their body, enriching their blood supply, and then filter it out of the blood into the digestive system. The older the dragon gets, the more efficiently they can do it, and the less the body relies on organic food, or the less fussy they become about what sort of organic food they're burning up. The flame is of magical origin, yes, but when it leaves the dragon mouth, it is technically now just non-magical, at least according to 5th edition D&D's declaration. I kind of agree with that in principle, but also, dragons often enhance their breath weapon with their own unique form of metamagic that allows them to alter the form and function of their breath weapon energy. So I wouldn't go into great detail on it here, but it's worthy of a whole video on its own. Also, specifically, red dragons tend not to simply reduce their victims to ash and pools of molten metal because they don't want to lose any potential treasure their victims are carrying, so they're more tactical in how they deploy it. Dragon magic is certainly a thing. It's a good reason why Draconic is the scholarly language of magic. The spell Mage Hand, for example, is modeled on a spell created by the gold dragon named Nexus called Hand. Dragons like this spell because their massive talons are not that great at fine manipulation of objects, and a literal little magical hand is very handy. Sorry. In the second edition Draconomicon, there's also a spell dragons used to find humanoid familiars. There's a spell called Venom Dust that creates one of the most toxic powders known, and the great red dragon named Thermal created the rare spell called Fire Trail, which is designed to create a contrail of fire droplets behind the dragon as it flies, which is excellent for setting humanoid towns and cities on fire, covering 30 feet per round in a soon-to-be blazing inferno. This is also highly effective against massed army troops and their siege weapons, which are usually made of a lot of flammable wood. Dragons also have their own version of resurrection and raise dead spells, which can reunite what they call the dragon anima with its body. The anima is their elemental spirit, so to speak. It's their version of a soul. Only very rare dragons know how to do this, however. On the whole, dragon magic does the same sort of thing that humanoid magic does. They quite like spells that kill thieves and interlopers, of course. They also like spells that protect them from other dragon attacks, and they like spells that vastly increase their power to spy on the lands around them or communicate with far-off places. Dragons aren't big users or creative of magical items. There are some exceptions, however, and a few of these are definitely worthy of note. I should point out, though, that these are only usable by dragons. If you happen to find a great big green obsidian sphere with a strange geometric pattern inlaid with pure gold all over it, this is the Orb of Draconic Influence and is used by powerful dragons to alter the behavior of all dragons within a range of 10 miles. The effect is delicate and influences all dragons in range equally, subtly changing their emotional state. The orb also grants the dragon protection from attack, making the attacker change their mind about attacking the dragon if they are fairly close to the orb. Plus, the orb blocks all forms of magical scrying or remote viewing of the lair it is located in. Circlets of the Worm are kind of the belts of giant strength for dragon kind. They allow a younger dragon to gain the power of an older dragon. Also, dragons make use of potions that allow them additional uses of their breath. Some items have a deceptive name, such as the Gauze of Appearance, which can make invisible creatures visible. They drape this delicate material over doorways or over the tops of parts of their treasure to reveal invisible interlopers. Dragons in general do have magical weapons that they strap onto limbs to enhance their physical attacks, but these sort of things are seen as kind of weak, so red dragons will typically not use magic fang enhancers or spiked tail rings and that sort of thing. Red dragons hoard all forms of treasure. While other dragon breeds might favour one type over another, reds really do covet everything of value, so they stock magic items in their lairs, absolutely. You'll always find weapons and armour, wondrous items, spellbooks, scrolls, relics, even the occasional artifact. Red dragon lairs obviously are of keen interest to every dungeon master, so here are the basics on what you can present to your players to give them that classic red dragon experience. The red loves to look over their domain. This means they favor mountains and hills because it can afford them a good perch high up to see everything, and also to be seen as the lord and master of their world. If there are no particularly high perches available, they will settle for wide open spaces where they have a very distant line of sight. This means that underground they will select or create a very large cavernous lair that allows them a good line of sight all around them and allow them to move around freely, if not flight, then at least wing-assisted leaps or jumping from one area to another. They're actually highly athletic beasts in combat, moving fast and unpredictably, closing and opening gaps, causing disruption to the enemy tactics. If the spellcaster decides to hang back and let the fighters close into melee range, the dragon will instantly reverse the situation and basically land on top of the spellcaster as soon as they can. On top of the spellcaster, preferably. They love volcanic, superheated, geothermally or elementally active areas. A natural gateway site that may connect to the elemental plane of fire inside a deep cavern reached from several openings in the peaks of some magnificent mountains is what a red dragon would consider to be the penthouse suite, prime real estate. Very difficult to get to, very dangerous to wander around, and full of rich thermal energy the dragon soaks up with pleasure. Kobolds propagate in red dragon lairs like dozers populate Fraggle Rock. As common as rats on a grain ship, red dragons just generally live with their presence and tolerate them, because the kobolds literally worship them like gods, and well, it's a very useful and appropriate attitude for a red dragon. Plus, kobolds rival dwarves in their skill at mining and excavation and do a wonderful job of loading precious metals and gems into the dragon's hoard. Kobolds act as messengers between the dragon lairs, and they also fetch creatures for the dragon to eat when it wants a snack and can't be bothered going hunting. Kobolds tend not to bother red dragons because those that do never survive to breeding age, and such negative traits just get weeded out of the gene pool. This may be also why kobolds don't tend to grow to large sizes, even though they are of draconic blood, which is something not often talked about. Without the rather mercurial pruning of their population by true dragon whims, perhaps kobolds would be a lot more like dragonborn. Due to their great size, dragons find narrow chasms on the floor of their lairs to be no bother at all, so they can just step over them. But these are certainly very dangerous for adventurers sneaking in to steal treasure. Plus, the kobolds build rope bridges and such that are not built to handle the weight of larger humanoids, so they really can't be trusted. The volcanic plumes and geysers, mud and magma pools in the lair produce exotic and toxic gases that don't affect the dragon or the kobolds, but can cause sickness in humanoids who spend too long in the lair. Particularly enterprising geologists, alchemists, and artificers have been known to scour every nook and cranny of old red dragon lairs for unique crystals which form there and nowhere else, infused with some measure of draconic magic. One can find giant fire beetles, dragon ticks the size of lobsters, parasites that mimic the appearance of gold coins, mimics, the amazingly pungent but quite handy underdark trash eaters, the troglodytes, and the urds, who you might think are just other kobolds, but they are actually quite a lot more complex, serving red dragons as their little eyes and ears in distant places, and red dragons love to keep tab on things, particularly each other. Page 52 of 3.5 edition's Draconomicon states, and I quote, "A red dragon is particularly interested in news about other red dragons, mostly because its own status relative to its peers remains a top concern. A red dragon's pride is easily wounded because any defeat or insult left unanswered causes a loss of that status. This is one reason why red dragons are prone to destructive rages. A red dragon usually can recover some lost status by just simply wreaking havoc. Every red dragon firmly believes that no being deserves to keep anything it has not strong enough to defend. Red dragons also apply this rule to their own kind. Occasionally, red dragons perceive weakness among one of their own kind, and the subject is not allowed to live. The victim is attacked, and the lair is stripped." I often get asked by people, if there are so many monsters in the world of Toril, how can any humanoid civilization survive? And dragons, being the top tier predators, make a perfect example to explain some things. First of all, dragons spend years and years just slumbering in their lair, doing pretty much absolutely nothing. Then they wake up for a few terrible months, cause death, destruction, fly off for weeks or months at a time, and then eventually they return and go back to sleep again. They're mainly just interested in having a massive banquet of fresh meat, hunting and fighting to stretch their wings and test out their older and more powerful body, then going and involving themselves with other dragons before returning, making sure everything is just how they like it, and going back to sleep. So for most of the time, humanoid species just leave the dragons alone and hope they don't wake up this year. The older the dragons get, the longer they sleep, so it's really just the younger dragons that are a real pain in the ass, and they are much easier for humanoids working together to deal with. People on Earth still get eaten every year by tigers. We haven't exterminated all the tigers or polar bears, for that matter. We just stay out of their way and know how best to avoid getting eaten. Dragons are a lot harder to avoid and deal with because they are highly intelligent and love to eat humanoids, but humanoids on Toril can hurl lightning bolts in mass. Highly motivated troops armed with long spears, ballistas, heavy crossbows, and most townsfolk build very sturdy cellars and sewers under their town, and they dive into them at the first yell of dragon that they hear. This may explain why there are so many dungeons. When you really think about it, dragons make people who make dungeons. Dungeons and dragons. There may certainly be those who make something of a reputation for themselves as hunters and killers of dragons, but for the most part, this would be those who claim they can rid some poor country folk of a particularly ravenous younger dragon who eats a lot of livestock and quite a few of the people along with them. That sort of dragon hunting is fine, respected even, but disturbing ancient dragons in their lairs is absolutely not fine with the locals, and dragon hunters who make it known that that's their plan may very well end up murdered before they get anywhere near the dragon. Don't forget that there are a lot of other draconic races, not least of which are the Dragonborn. Personally, I'm glad that the lore has moved away from Dragonborn being the result of a ritual transformation of the servants dedicated to the cause of Bahamut and the fight against the evil spawn of Tiamat. That was far too narrow a path for a proper player character race in D&D, if you ask me. It also restricted the relationship between the true dragons and the Dragonborn. Now it's wide open to all sorts of possibilities. I can just picture a kingdom with an ancient red dragon that dwells in the nearby mountains. It tends to wake up when the volcano in that mountain range starts to get active. So on first signs of plumes of ash and earth tremors, the people of the kingdom gather up tribute and drove a tribute of livestock up to the high country. Among the population, there'd be many dragonborn, a fair few dragon-blooded sorcerers, perhaps even some dragon blood in the royal family. And the kingdom's banners proudly display their fearsome red dragon. Oh yes, someone also asked if red dragons are the ancestors of other dragons. No, they're not. The first dragons on Faerûn were the Eurodraco. From incomplete fossils laboriously reconstructed, sages have determined that Eurodraco was similar in size and configuration to the modern Wyvern, averaging 35 feet long with a 50-foot wingspan. No evidence was found indicating that Eurodraco had the tail sting of a modern wyvern, and it's nowhere near as intelligent as a modern wyvern, which are not that smart anyway, so Eurodraco was as stupid as a bag of ogres. However, back then it was still smarter than all the other thunder beasts from the age before the creator races. This was long before the planet Toril was hit by the Tears of Saloon, which marked a remarkable evolutionary leap in the proto-dragons that saw the first fire-breathing forms of the dragons. I think it's much more likely that this was due to the meddling of gods, but it's a hotly debated mystery, so no real answers. Even the fossil record can't really be trusted on Toril. True red dragons developed at the same time as the rest of the chromatic dragons, due to the influence of the draconic gods on Toril, namely Bahamut and Tiamat, who are particularly important. Even though they don't even rank very high in the draconic pantheon, they just happen to have picked Toril as the site of most of their rivalry, and the resulting split between chromatic and metallic dragons is thanks to them. On other planets, the lack of Tiamat and Bahamut is mirrored by the lack of clear divides between dragon breeds. For example, from the Birthright campaign setting, Vor Lekiniskai is a master fireworm, which is similar to a red dragon, except in his case he can breathe not just fire but also molten rock, like a volcano. His breath weapon is so dangerous that it can cause him internal damage if he uses it too often. Luckily, he is kind of merged with a mountain, and which causes him a lot of tactical disadvantages, but still, fireworms of the planet Cerulea are formidable and thankfully quite rare. You can find the stats for Vor in Dragon Magazine number 248, an issue packed with dragon-related articles. There are dragons on most worlds. One exception is Athys, the World of the Dark Sun campaign setting, where the dragons there are not born dragons, they are transformed defiler humans and half-elves who've transformed themselves into potent psychic dragons. The most famous of which is the Dragon of Terror, but there are many others on that blighted world. In the Pathfinder RPG, the lore of red dragons is, as you would expect, very similar to D&D. Where they differ a little is their ability to radiate heat from their body and some cosmetic differences to keep the lawyers happy. Pathfinder actually does a wonderful job of explaining the relationship between red and gold dragons though, and at this point I think I better talk about dragon breeds and their sizes, because 5th edition D&D just seems to sort of assume players are supposed to know how big red dragons are. Let me remedy that. Dragons are classified by the age category and by their size category. The two go hand in hand, but not all breeds are the same. Only the red, gold, and silver dragons can reach the colossal size category. All the other metallic and chromatic dragons sort of stop growing larger once they hit gargantuan size. Now, I have to point out that again, dragon size varies between different editions of D&D. In earlier editions, they just keep on growing larger and larger, and the dragon sizes can vary on different world settings, so it's very tricky giving hard definitive answers. The more you research this stuff, the more slippery the facts become. So around 2nd edition, it is possible to encounter a great worm, i.e. a very, very old red dragon that has a body measuring 183 feet in length, not counting a tail that is 171 feet long. That looks something like this. That is a Los Angeles class attack submarine for comparison. It also has a man standing on it, just to give you an accurate scale of just how big a great red worm red dragon actually is. As you can see, they are very big, and the sheer destruction they can inflict on pretty much anything is very, very impressive. Dragon sizes vary mainly on how fast they grow and how common the really large dragons are for each breed. The ferocious white and black dragons less commonly get to really large sizes because they have a high mortality rate. The gold dragons start off bigger than other dragon breeds and are very reclusive, so they tend to survive to great age. The silver and red dragons are similar in many ways and have comparable sizes. The copper dragons, which also prefer a mountain terrain, tend to run into red dragons more often, and the reds tend to just be bigger and stronger for their age category, so it's a balance of potential size, the dragon's age, and overall environmental factors. Red dragons regard other dragons with varying degrees of suspicion and contempt. They consider the white dragons to be stupid and weaker than them, but with admirable viciousness, and they respect the white dragons' hunting prowess, particularly when it comes to ambush tactics, and they have a grudging respect for all the dragons that can move freely through the water, as that is something red dragons loathe to do and is a potential weakness that they do not broadcast to their enemies. They generally ignore black, green, and blue dragons unless there is some reason not to, such as one of them showing up in their territory or being very active at the same time they are, which can result in a good brawl and severe beating of the lesser dragon just to make the red dragon feel good about itself. Reds despise the underhanded weakness of the black dragons and their treachery. They consider copper dragons to be foolish, bronze dragons too obsessed with past glory and not focused enough on the here and now, blue dragons too tolerant and perhaps too reliant on lesser creatures, particularly crowding the filthy things into their lairs like that. Silver dragons they hate due to them being metallics, but they also secretly respect them as their primary rivals outside of the other reds. They never need an excuse to pick a fight with a silver dragon. The only exception is when all the dragons have called a truce for some sort of traditional meeting concerning matters that apply to all dragon kind, in which case they afford extraordinary respect for all other dragons present, because that level of self-control adds to their status in those specific circumstances. Gold dragons, as we know, they hate for a number of reasons, not least of which is their size and power, but also the fact that golds invade their dreams and beat them without even a fair fight. It's just intolerable. The dragons on Toril have long ago moved away from their old draconic religion, but the pantheon still exists and the dragon gods are still acknowledged. Red dragons tend to respect Asgarath, or Io, as the draconic creation force, as do all other dragons. They also pay lip service to Astolabor, the goddess of wealth, Garrix, the mighty red destroyer, and of course, high on their list of respect, they also quite like Task, the god of greed. They frequently rant about Zorquan and why they are the exemplars of dragonness, according to some misquoted thing Zorquan is said to say or represent. And of course, they all respect and appease Tiamat. Mainly, this is only on Toril and within spitting distance of Tiamat. Though Tiamat is not a greater deity, she just happens to have a real keen interest in Toril for some reason, along with her hated brother Bahamut. Talking of Toril, I've been asked to talk about famous red dragons. Well, Cloth is certainly one of the most famous. Old Snarl is well in excess of 1300 years old, which is well beyond the normal life expectancy of a red dragon. Normally they would top out at around 1200 years before they either vanish, traveling to one of the mythical dragon graveyards and releasing their essence into the great beyond, or they'll invest their essence into a location becoming a draconic guardian, or they'll embrace the conversion into becoming a Dracolich. There are other forms of undead dragons, by the way. I will be talking about them in another video at some point. Hloth lives and is unusually active still across all northwest Faerun. The spine of the World Mountains are his home turf, and Clothan Vale, which is much closer to the city of Luskan than anyone should feel comfortable with. That valley is packed with sheep and goats and rothe, and the mountains around there have a lot of caves, two of which are lairs of old Snarl. Though to gain access, you have to be able to lift a massive stone slab that Cloth put there. It's really, really heavy. Cloth made the valley his home after he fought three other dragons and got badly wounded, almost losing a wing and having half his body frozen solid. There's a rumor that this valley has a magical spring that boosts healing, and there's a location there called Arothrin's Well in the middle of the valley where you can find it east of Ravenrock and west of Mirabar with healing waters. Cloth extends his lifespan by consuming the essence of unborn red dragons directly from their eggs, so he is widely hated and feared by other dragons. He has attacked the city of Mirabar in the past, thanks mainly to the Dragon Rage Mythal, and is known to have consumed entire hordes of orcs in the spine of World Mountains. He is certainly one of the largest dragons in Faerun, and the Worm of the North is closely watched by pretty much everyone. I'd say that Cloth is something of a unifier, because when he is spotted outside of his lair, everyone puts aside their rivalries and bands together for sheer survival. Chazar needs a mention as well. The story of this dragon is very complicated thanks to him being a fiendish red dragon that could shapeshift into a humanoid form. He died in 1479 of the Dale Reckoning calendar, but in his prime he was a force of pure chaos and evil. He was convinced of his superiority over all living things, even more so than a typical red dragon, which is saying something, and while he demanded absolute loyalty from his subjects and minions, he saw them as nothing more than expendable pawns. He ruled in Luthquick in Chisenta in his humanoid form, a handsome, angular-faced man with yellow eyes, perfect teeth, and slightly pointed ears. He rose to power in humanoid form by his efforts of unifying Chisentan cities in rebellion against the Empire of Untha, which he succeeded, and he was crowned king. He then created a temple for himself, claiming divinity, and went off slaughtering hordes of Sahuagin, sending visions of his humanoid form standing on a massive pile of their bodies, but when his humanoid alter ego never returned, he became a martyr, a legend to his people, fueling his planned path to godhood. Unfortunately, Tiamat got tangled up in his fate and really did the dirty to Chazar, who actually saved Tiamat only to have her eat him. And then she later brought him back to life and he went back to ruling Chisenta for a while before the spell plague threw him into the Shadowfell, and he got fed on by an evil blight worm named Seelragoth for 100 years before he was rescued and went back to ruling Chisenta from Luthchek. But eventually, the group that rescued him, the Brotherhood of the Griffin, was responsible for betraying him, and he was killed by Sharla Karanok, who was kind of the steward of Chisenta while the dragon was missing in action, and ended up getting thrown in a dungeon by him for a while. The jury is still out as to if this is the last we've heard of Chazar. I highly doubt it that we've seen the last of him. Now, as to creatures of magic and primordial power, dragons are most comfortable dwelling in the primaterial plane and the elemental planes. But I've been asked how the different planes of existence influence the dragons. For the reds, obviously the elemental plane of fire is delicious, but it's a bit too much for the younger dragons to handle, really. So it's really just the mature red dragons that dwell there, and that makes it even more dangerous for the young reds. Plus, the elemental power of the plane of fire is teeming with elemental spirits. It's infested, so to speak, whereas the pure power of a volcanic caldera on the primordial plane is clean and fresh. The teeming elemental spirits worm their way through the essence of the ancient red dragons and can drive them fairly insane or cause an unhealthy imbalance that can result in their biological side becoming actually rocky, volcanic, painfully out of sorts with their primordial nature, which may see them become something more akin to a catastrophic dragon, no more than a raging force of elemental destruction and no longer desirable as a mate for the rest of dragonkind. The elemental plane of fire is limitless in space, but the majority of that space is too furious even for a red dragon to tolerate in its material form. On death, the essence of a red dragon no longer has that restriction, and they can be set free to explore an entirely different existence in the deepest reaches of the elemental plane of fire, dancing in the hearts of stars across the multiverse, completely free forever. In the upper planes, dragons face entirely different problems, but planes that respond well to their strength of will, of a draconic mind, are ideal places to set up their own little realms, a safe and secure domain to hoard their most valuable treasures. Still, there is a lack of the elemental power that they crave, and they really don't like rubbing shoulders with gods, who exist simply to challenge the firm belief that they are the perfect form of life, and basically the reason the primordial plane exists at all. There is that slightly unreal quality to the outer planes as well, and also, there are other planet dragons there which certainly don't make life easy for interloper primordial dragons attempting to overstay a welcome they were never offered. So red dragons tend to be a little more common in the plane of Limbo or the Astral Sea, the Ethereal Plane, and the Elemental and Para-Elemental planes, but much less common elsewhere, and they certainly don't much like the parallel planes of the Shadowfell and the Feywild, the Realm of Dreams, mainly because the damned metallic dragons do quite like those places, and the Shadowfell is just a miserable place that can taint a dragon permanently with its shadow. There are no hard and set rules for how the planes influence the dragons, how long it takes, and so on, but I hope that goes some way to explaining the dragon's attitude toward them. Now, shall we take a look at red dragon game mechanics? In the latest edition of D&D, we have four stat blocks. The Wyrmling, which is a medium-sized dragon, challenge rating 4, that has a bite attack and a breath weapon, immunity to fire but not much else. The name is a bit confusing, as in earlier editions, a Wyrmling is a newly hatched dragon infant. Now it sort of skips the first 10 years of a dragon's life and starts off at that late stage of a very young to the later stage of a juvenile dragon, so between 10 and 50 years of age, when the dragon first goes looking for some sort of lair. Before then, they essentially wander, hunting and camping in lairs of opportunity, such as feeding on hibernating bears and sleeping in the dens between meals. They then move up to young adult dragon in 5th edition. This represents between 51 and 100 years of age. These are the red dragons that are of most concern to farmers, travelling merchants, frontier settlements, and so on. As a dragon passes 50 years of age, it's entering its breeding age, and it's looking to establish a lair and start seriously collecting hordes of treasure. So this is also the age where they may depart for the astral plane to serve Tiamat and join the Githyanki. The young adult stat block gives us a large dragon, challenge rating 10, now able to attack with tooth and claw. They have lair actions, but they're far from being legendary creatures, and it's still quite a risk of being murdered by a band of adventuring humanoids. And of course, other dragons, behirs, rocks, and so on. Then, past a century old, the red dragon is now an adult. As it enters the second century of life, the red dragon adult's physically growth begins to slow, but it's now entering the prime of its life, concentrating on honing its mental and physical capabilities, confident and secure enough in a well-established lair to start a study of arcane magic. It not only collects treasures from vanquished foes and plundered locations, it also studies the treasures, including the magic items and spell books, relics of faiths, alchemical creations, potions and wondrous constructions, figuring out how they relate to its own more instinctual magical powers. The adult red dragon is huge, challenge rating 17, and has all those all-important legendary actions as well as lair actions. Finally, we have the ancient red dragon stat block, which crams all the other life stages beyond 200 years into one listing. It's a formidable gargantuan monster, challenge rating 24, and while no extra features are added, all the existing ones are more powerful as you would expect. Now, this video is long enough and I'm not going to go over all of these details. You don't need me to repeat everything you can find for yourself in the Monster Manual, but I can give you some tips on making a red dragon the serious threat they really should be and have them survive for more than the first few rounds of combat. What most DMs forget about is that the lair of a red dragon is toxic and very hot. The waves of heat, the plumes of noxious gas make vision obscured, terrain difficult, and what would normally be a regular short-range missile or spell attack behaves more like a long-range attack, suffering disadvantage on the attack rolls. Red dragons prefer to stay on the ground to fight because they are brutal, massive, powerful opponents and have more attacks per round than adventurers, allowing them to simply concentrate all their attacks on selected targets and take them out one by one. Dragons are very smart. The adult red dragon's intelligence is 16, which means they can predict what the player characters are going to do to a certain extent and preemptively mess with those actions. If this sounds like I'm saying it's okay to cheat a little bit, I'm not. I'm just saying it's okay to not cut your players so much slack and let the dragon actually single them out and murder them, just like you would if you were that dragon. I'm saying be the dragon, think like the dragon, What you know about the player characters is pretty much what a 2-century-old dragon would be able to deduce about them in only a little bit of observation, and dragons have very, very sharp senses. When is the last time your player character party ever managed to get within close range of a dragon without any chatter, without any botched stealth rolls, without setting off any alarms, with any trap, or disturb any creatures on the way that would cry out, growl, squeal, roar, or yell at them? And when is the last time one of your players thought, oh, right, if I fire a bow and miss, that arrow is going to hit something hard and go snap, clatter, 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 plink? Yeah, never, right? So 100% that dragon is well aware that they're coming well before they get there and has actually set up all sorts of mayhem before they arrive. Wooden ceiling supports that hold back tons of loose rock? Sure. Hit one with a tail swipe or burn through it with a breath weapon and it not only crushes those under it and creates an area of difficult or impassable terrain, but it also kicks up a plume of obscuring and choking dust. Really think about this stuff. What would you do if you could breathe a cone of fire? Don't leave victims enough space to get out of the way. Fill the tunnel they are forced to approach by with a raging inferno. Are the players critically failing their saves versus breath weapons and taking serious damage? Their spellbooks and scrolls, torches, clothing, backpacks, leather boots and such are not automatically fireproof. Set the damn things on fire! Sure, the wizard can douse the flaming spellbook in one action, but that's an action lost. Can they get those verbal spell components out if they're choking on poisonous clouds of sulfur? Not likely, man. Did you just hit the fighter in full plate with a direct blast of fire? Great. Now they are taking a few points of heat damage the next round because their metal armor is red hot and the cloth padding under it is actually smoldering against their skin. Do you think the dragons never pick up boulders and hurl them just like giants do? They've been fighting giants for thousands of years. Of course they're going to use this excellent tactic. Piles of sand scattered throughout the lair, the wing beats can create cones of wind that blast sand into the victim's eyes. Somebody pointed out that they are so large that the wing beats would actually break the speed of sound and snap as they travel through the air, blinding and obscuring with clouds of kicked up sand. The red dragon is highly agile for a large creature. They're also excellent climbers. So think three-dimensionally. The roof and walls of a cavern are just more floor space for them to leap from one spot to another. They can easily jump into the middle of a party of adventurers and lay into all of them using wing attacks on their opponents to knock multiple targets prone. Red dragons don't just sit still and take missile and ranged spell attacks while they go toe-to-toe with a melee fighter. They will close to melee range with the ranged opponents and then attack from range against melee opponents. They understand spellcasting and concentration checks. They'll use healing potions. They'll load up with enchantments to protect themselves and enhance their attacks. Notice that adult red dragons have 60-foot blind sight? That means they can keep fighting perfectly well in total obscurement, not just darkness. Poison, fire, sandstorms, flying boulders, rock falls, lava pools, splashing lava with tail slams. And we have not even considered that the dragon has a small army of fanatical guerrilla fighting kobolds on its side as well. Masses of kobolds attacking with simple ranged attacks from a reasonable distance and cover can whittle down adventurers extremely quickly. The dragon rarely attacks on its own within its lair, and they don't hesitate to make use of their own hoarded magic item and monstrous pets at every opportunity. A red dragon and a couple of hellfire oozes made one gnarly fight in an old 4th edition campaign, and I certainly didn't stick to the rules because every dragon in my campaign world has some sort of a quirk. Think of the Kung Fu movies. You fight through all the minions to get to the rival Kung Fu master, and they're attacking you with, in every possible way they could, with a wooden chair or something. It's their thing, they're masters of the deadly chair. Red dragons do the same sort of thing, but it could be hellhounds, or fire newts, or salamanders, or fire elementals, or Galeb Dur or some such. Imagine if they threw a boulder in it, then it got up and started attacking you. Your players are not just fighting a dragon, they're fighting their own lack of caution. They're fighting their own misconceptions, they're fighting their lack of respect for the terrain, their lack of tactics dealing with mobs of minions, and their lack of agility to deal with a dragon that they can't get anywhere near because it keeps blinding them, or poisoning them, or bludgeoning them, or immolating them. Also, dragons can cast spells, and they can seek out lairs that have special properties well beyond the samples that they present for you in the Monster Manual to inspire you. So think about earth motes, acid lakes, steam mephits, dragon cultists, wards, circles, oozes, mimics, elementals, magical ruins, planar portals, summoned devils, the spawn of Tiamat, and things like golems, animated armor, or weapons, and other weirdness. If you really think about all the ways that you can enhance your encounter, even a lower level dragon becomes one of the most dynamic, dangerous monster fights that you can offer, which is entirely appropriate in a game that is named after them. Please hit the like button if you made it this far. Subscribe if you like what I do. Check out my Subscribestar or Patreon links for all the full scripts for these videos. Buy some Teespring merchandise. Wear your geek with pride. And as always, thanks for listening, and I'll be back with more for you very soon.